Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Alice and Bob Learn Application Security by Tanya Janca. Narrated by Tanya Janca. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchase this audiobook from to request the material. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. The publisher and the author make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work and specifically disclaim all warranties, including, without limitation, warranties of fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales or promotional materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for every situation. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering legal, accounting, or professional services. If professional assistance is required, the services of a competent professional person should be sought. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. The fact that an organization or website is referred to in this work as a citation and/or a potential source of further information does not mean that the author or the publisher endorses the information the organization or website may provide or recommendations it may make. Further, one should be aware that internet websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is heard. For general information on our other products and services, please contact our customer care department within the United States at 877-762-2974, outside the United States at 317-572-3993, or fax 317-572-4002. Wiley publishes in a variety of print and electronic formats and by print on demand. Some material included with standard print versions of this book may not be included in ebooks or in print on demand. If this book refers to media such as a CD or DVD that is not included in the version you purchased, you may download this material at booksupport.wiley.com. For more information about Wiley products, visit www.wiley.com. I dedicate this book to my tireless cheering squad, Lexi, Mateus, Ash, and Vane. Your constant support, encouragement, and celebration of each milestone kept me going. Also, thank you for not judging me for how much ice cream I ate during my editing. Foreword. There have been dramatic advances in application security over the past several years, with many forces at play forcing organizations to care about the security of their software. The rise of security incidents as a result of insecure software, the growing number of regulations that force companies to care about information security, and the growing dependence of internet-enabled software. Organizations of every size and sector of business and government have experienced breaches and the loss that goes with it. However, these growing number of information security events also bring awareness that helps push organizations and the developers within them to build more secure software. While awareness around the cost of insecure software has risen, it's not enough. We need surgical advice and clear engineering strategies to build secure software. Enterprises who wish to build secure software must turn their focus to a new way of engineering that includes changes to the famous trilogy of people, process, and technology. That's where Alice and Bob come in. Tanya's book lays out the subject of application security in a clear and concise way, allowing the audience to apply what they have learned as they flow through the book. The chapters are peppered with tales of Alice and Bob, and how the security decisions we make affect real people's lives. The book starts with an explanation of the importance of this topic, then teaches all of the main security concepts that we all seem to pick up somewhere, but we're never quite sure how it happened. From security requirements for web applications to secure design concepts, secure coding guidelines to common pitfalls, it's sprinkled with stories, examples with Alice or Bob, and diagrams. It also covers testing and deployment, but it's certainly not a book about hacking. It's about how to ensure that your applications are tough, rugged, and secure. The book describes how to create an AppSec program, how to secure modern technologies and systems, habits for developers or anyone to keep themselves and their systems safe, and even includes a learning plan at the end. With tips, tricks, and even jokes, this is not your average textbook. I hope that you enjoy this book as much as I did, and that you decide to fight the good fight with Tanya and me by building secure software. Jim Manico, founder, secure coding instructor, Manicode Security. Introduction. Why application security? Why should you listen to this book? Why is security important? Why is it so hard? If you have picked up this book, you likely already know the answer to this question. You have seen the headlines of companies that have been hacked, data breached, identities stolen, businesses and lives ruined. However, you may not be aware that the number one reason for data breaches is insecure software, causing between 26 and 40% of leaked and stolen records. Yet when we look at the budgets of most companies, the amount allocated toward ensuring their software is secure is usually much, much lower than that. Most organizations at this point are highly skilled at protecting their network perimeter with firewalls, enterprise security, blocking malware and not allowing admin rights for most users, and physical security, badging in and out of secure areas. That said, reliably creating secure software is still an elusive goal for most organizations today. Why? Right now, universities and colleges are teaching students how to code, but not teaching them how to ensure the code they write is secure, nor are they teaching them even the basics of information security. Most post-secondary programs that do cover security just barely touch upon application security, concentrating instead on identity, network security, and infrastructure. Imagine if someone went to school to become an electrician, but they never learned about safety. Houses would catch fire from time to time because the electricians wouldn't know how to ensure the work that they did was safe. Allowing engineering and computer science students to graduate with inadequate security training is equally dangerous, as they create banking software, software that runs pacemakers, software that safeguards government secrets, and so much more that our society depends on. This is one part of the problem. Another part of the problem is that English language training is generally extremely expensive, making it unobtainable for many. There is also no clear career path or training program that a person can take to become a secure coder, security architect, incident responder, or application security engineer. Most people end up with on-the-job training, which means that each of us has a completely different idea of how to do things, with varying results. Adding to this problem is how profitable it is to commit crimes on the internet. And with attribution, figuring out who did the crime, being so difficult, there are many, many threats facing any application hosted on the internet. The more valuable the system or the data within it, the more threats it will face. The last part of this equation is that application security is quite difficult. Unlike infrastructure security, where every version of Microsoft Windows Server 2008 R2 Service Pack 2 is exactly the same, each piece of custom software is a snowflake, unique by design. When you build a deck out of wood in your backyard and you go to the hardware store to buy a 2x4 that is 8 feet long, it will be the same in every store you go to, meaning you can make safe assumptions and calculations. With software, this is almost never the case. You must never make any assumptions and you must verify every fact. This means brute force memorization, automated tools, and other one-size-fits-all solutions rarely work. And that makes application security, as a field, very challenging. Pushing left. If you consider the system development lifecycle, SDLC, the various phases move right. Requirements come before design, which comes before coding. Whether you are doing Agile, Waterfall, DevOps, or any other software development methodology, you always need to know what you are building, requirements, make a plan, design, build it, coding, verifying it does all that it should do and nothing more, testing, then release and maintain it, deployment. Often security activities start in the release or testing phases, far to the right, and quite late in the project. The problem with this is that the later in the process that you fix a flaw, design problem, or a bug, implementation problem, the more it costs and the harder it is to do. Let me explain this a different way. Imagine Alice and Bob are building a house. They have saved for this project for years, and the contractors are putting the final touches on it by putting up the wallpaper and adding handles on the cupboards. Alice turns to Bob and says, "Honey, we have two children, but only one bathroom. How is this going to work?" If they tell the contractors to stop working, the house won't be finished on time. If they ask them to add a second bathroom, where will it go? How much will it cost? Finding out this late in their project would be disastrous. However, if they had figured this out in the requirements phase or during the design phase, it would have been easy to add more bathrooms for very little cost. The same is true for solving security problems. This is where shifting left comes into play. The earlier you can start doing security activities during a software development project, the better the results will be. The arrows in figure I2 show a progression of starting security earlier and earlier in your projects. We will discuss later on what these activities are. About this book. This book will teach you the foundations of application security, AppSec for short. That is, how to create secure software. This book is for software developers, information security professionals wanting to know more about the security of software, and anyone who wants to work in the field of application security, which includes penetration testing, aka ethical hacking. If you are a software developer, it is your job to make the most secure software that you know how to make. Your responsibility here cannot be understated. There are hundreds of programmers for every AppSec engineer in the field, and we cannot do it without you. This book is the first step on the right path. Afterward, you should know enough to make secure software and know where to find answers if you are stuck. Notes on format. There will be examples of how security issues can potentially affect real users, with the characters Alice and Bob making several appearances throughout the book. You may recall the characters of Alice and Bob from other security examples. They have been being used to simplify complex topics in our industry since the advent of cryptography and encryption. Out-of-scope topics. Brief note on topics that are out of scope for this book. Incident response, IR. Network monitoring and alerting. Cloud security. Infrastructure security. Network security. Security operations. Identity and access management, IAM. Enterprise security, support, anti-phishing, reverse engineering, code obfuscation, and other advanced defense techniques, as well as every other type of security not listed here. Some of these topics will be touched upon, but are in no way covered exhaustively in this book. Please consume additional resources to learn more about these important topics. The answer key. At the end of each chapter are exercises to help you learn and to test your knowledge. There is an answer key at the end of the book. However, it will be incomplete. Many of the questions could be an essay, research paper, or online discussion in themselves, while others are personal in nature. Only you can answer the roadblocks you may be facing in your workplace. With this in mind, the answer key is made up of answers when possible, examples when appropriate, and some skipped questions left for online discussion. In the months following the publication of this book, you will be able to stream recorded discussions answering all of the exercise questions online at youtube.com/shehackspurple under the playlist Alice and Bob Learn Application Security. You can subscribe to learn about new videos, watch the previous videos, and explore other free content. You can participate live in the discussions by subscribing to the She Hacks Purple newsletter to receive invitations to the streams, plus a lot of other free content at newsletter.shehackspurple.ca. It doesn't cost anything to attend the discussions or watch them afterward, and you can learn a lot by hearing others' opinions, ideas, successes, and failures. Please join us. Part 1. What you must know to write code safe enough to put on the internet. In this part, Chapter 1, Security Fundamentals. Chapter 2, Security Requirements. Chapter 3, Secure Design. Chapter 4, Secure Code. Chapter 5, Common Pitfalls. Chapter 1, Security Fundamentals. Before learning how to create secure software, you need to understand several key security concepts. There is no point in memorizing how to implement a concept if you don't understand when or why you need it. Learning these principles will ensure you make secure project decisions and are able to argue for better security when you face opposition. Also, knowing the reason behind security rules makes them a lot easier to live with. The Security Mandate, CIA. The mandate and purpose of every IT security team is to protect the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of the systems and the data of the company, government, or organization that they work for. This is why the security team hassles you about having unnecessary administrator rights on your work machine, won't let you plug in unknown devices into the network, and wants you to do all the other things that feel inconvenient. They want to protect these three things. We call it the CIA triad for short. Let's examine this with our friends Alice and Bob. Alice has type 1 diabetes and uses a tiny device implanted in her arm to check her insulin several times a day, while Bob has a smart pacemaker that regulates his heart, which he accesses via a mobile app on his phone. Both of these devices are referred to as IoT medical device implants in our industry. Figure 1-1. The CIA triad is the reason IT security teams exist. Note: IoT stands for Internet of Things, physical products that are internet connected. A smart toaster or fridge that talks to the internet are IoT devices. Confidentiality. Alice is the CEO of a large Fortune 500 company, and although she is not ashamed that she is a type 1 diabetic, she does not want this information to become public. She is often interviewed by the media and does public speaking, serving as a role model for many other women in her industry. Alice works hard to keep her personal life private, and this includes her health condition. She believes that some people within her organization are after her job and would do anything to try to portray her as weak in an effort to undermine her authority. If her device was to accidentally leak her information, showing itself on public networks, or if her account information became part of a breach, this would be highly embarrassing for her and potentially damaging to her career. Keeping her personal life private is important to Alice. Bob, on the other hand, is open about his heart condition and happy to tell anyone that he has a pacemaker. He has a great insurance plan with the federal government and is grateful that when he retires, he can continue with his plan despite his pre-existing condition. Confidentiality is not a priority for Bob in this respect. Figure 1-2. Confidentiality, keeping things safe. Note: confidentiality is often undervalued in our personal lives. Many people tell me they have nothing to hide. Then I ask, "Do you have curtains on your windows at home? Why? I thought you had nothing to hide." I'm a blast at parties. Integrity. Integrity in data, figure 1-3, means that the data is current, correct, and accurate. Integrity also means that your data has not been altered during transmission. The correct value must be maintained during transit. Integrity in a computer system means that the results it gives are precise and factual. For Bob and Alice, this may be the most crucial of the CIA factors. If either of their systems gives them incorrect treatment, it could result in death. For a human being, as opposed to a company or nation state, there does not exist a more serious repercussion than end of life. The integrity of their health systems is crucial to ensuring they both remain in good health. Figure 1-3. Integrity means accuracy. CIA is the very core of our entire industry. Without understanding this from the beginning and how it affects your teammates, your software, and most significantly, your users, you cannot build secure software. Availability. If Alice's insulin measuring device was unavailable due to malfunction, tampering, or dead batteries, her device would not be available. Since Alice usually checks her insulin levels several times a day, but she's able to do manual testing of her insulin by pricking her finger and using a medical kit designed for this purpose, if she needs to, it is somewhat important to her that this service is available. A lack of availability of this system would be quite inconvenient for her, but not life-threatening. Bob, on the other hand, has irregular heartbeats from time to time and never knows when his arrhythmia will strike. If Bob's pacemaker was not available when his heart was behaving erratically, this could be a life or death situation if enough time elapsed. It is vital that his pacemaker is available and that it reacts in real time, immediately, when an emergency happens. Bob works for the federal government as a clerk managing secret and top secret documents and has for many years. He is a proud grandfather and has been trying hard to live a healthy life since his pacemaker was installed. Note, medical devices are generally real-time software systems. Real-time means the system must respond to changes in the fastest amount of time possible, generally in milliseconds. It cannot have delays. The responses must be as close as possible to instantaneous or immediate. When Bob's arrhythmia starts, his pacemaker must act immediately. There cannot be a delay. Most applications are not real-time. If there is a 10-millisecond delay in the purchase of new running shoes or in predicting traffic changes, it is not truly critical. Figure 1.4. Resilience improves availability. Note, many customers move to the cloud for the sole reason that it is extremely reliable, almost always available, when compared to more traditional in-house data center service levels. As you can see in Figure 1.4, resilience improves availability, making public cloud an attractive option from a security perspective. The following are security concepts that are well known within the information security industry. It is essential to have a good grasp of these foundational ideas in order to understand how the rest of the topics in this book apply to them. If you are already a security practitioner, you may not need this chapter. Assume breach. There are two types of companies: those that have been breached, and those that don't know they've been breached yet. It's such a famous saying in the information security industry that we don't even know who to attribute it to anymore. It may sound pessimistic, but for those of us who work in incident response, forensics, or other areas of investigation, we know this is only too true. The concept of assume breach means preparation and design considerations to ensure that if someone were to gain unapproved access to your network, application, data, or other systems, it would prove difficult, time-consuming, expensive, and risky, and you would be able to detect and respond to the situation quickly. It also means monitoring and logging your systems to ensure that if you don't notice until after a breach occurs, at least you can find out what did happen. Many systems also monitor for behavioral changes or anomalies to detect potential breaches. It means preparing for the worst in advance to minimize damage, time to detect, and mediation efforts. Let's look at two examples of how we can apply this principle, a consumer example and a professional example. As a consumer, Alice opens an online document sharing account. If she were to assume breach, she wouldn't upload anything sensitive or valuable there. For instance, unregistered intellectual property, photos of a personal nature that could damage her professional or personal life, business secrets, government secrets, etc. She would also set up monitoring of the account, as well as have a plan if the documents were stolen, changed, removed, shared publicly, or otherwise accessed in an unapproved manner. Lastly, she would monitor the entire internet in case they were leaked somewhere. This would be an unrealistic amount of responsibility to expect from a regular consumer. This book does not advise average consumers to assume breach in their lives, although doing occasional online searches on yourself is a good idea, and not uploading sensitive documents online is definitely advisable. As a professional, Bob manages secret and top-secret documents. The department Bob works at would never consider the idea of using an online file-sharing service to share their documents. They control every aspect of this valuable information. When they were creating the network and the software systems that manage these documents, they designed them and their processes assuming breach. They hunt for threats in their network, design their network using zero trust, monitor the internet for signs of data leakage, authenticate to APIs before connecting, verify data from the database and from internal APIs, perform red team exercises, security testing and production, and monitor their network and applications closely for anomalies or other signs of breach. They've written automated responses to common attack patterns, have processes in place and ready for uncommon attacks, and they analyze behavioral patterns for signs of breach. They operate on the idea that data may have been breached already or could be at any time. Another example of this would be initiating your incident response process when a serious bug has been disclosed via your responsible disclosure or bug bounty program, assuming that someone else has potentially already found and exploited this bug in your systems. According to Wikipedia, coordinated disclosure is a vulnerability disclosure model in which a vulnerability or an issue is disclosed only after a period of time that allows for the vulnerability or issue to be patched or mended. Bug bounty programs are run by many organizations. They provide recognition and compensation for security researchers who report bugs, especially those pertaining to vulnerabilities. Insider threats. An insider threat means that someone who has approved access to your systems, network, and data, usually an employee or consultant, negatively affects one or more of the CIA aspects of your systems, data, and/or network. This can be malicious, on purpose, or accidental. Here are some examples of malicious threats and the parts of the CIA triad they affect. An employee downloading intellectual property onto a portable drive, leaving the building, and then selling the information to your competitors. Confidentiality. An employee deleting a database and its backup on their last day of work because they are angry that they were dismissed. Availability. An employee programming a backdoor into a system so they can steal from your company. Integrity and confidentiality. An employee downloading sensitive files from another employee's computer and using them for blackmail. Confidentiality. An employee accidentally deleting files, then changing logs to cover their mistake, integrity, and availability. An employee not reporting a vulnerability to management in order to avoid the work of fixing it. Potentially all three, depending upon the type of vulnerability. Here are some examples of accidental threats and the parts of the CIA triad they affect. Employees using software improperly, causing it to fall into an unknown state. Potentially all three. An employee accidentally deleting valuable data, files, or even entire systems. Availability. An employee accidentally misconfiguring software, the network, or other software in a way that introduces security vulnerabilities. Potentially all three. An inexperienced employee pointing a web proxy, dynamic application security testing, DAST, tool at one of your internal applications, crashing the application, availability, or polluting your database, integrity. We will cover how to avoid this in later chapters to ensure all of your security testing is performed safely. Warning: web proxy software and/or DAST tools are generally forbidden on professional work networks. Also known as web app scanners, web proxies are hacker tools and can cause great damage. Never point a web app scanner at a website or application and perform active scanning or other interactive testing without permission. It must be written permission from someone with the authority to give the permission. Using a DAST tool to interact with a site on the internet without permission is a criminal act in many countries. Be careful, and when in doubt, always ask before you start. Defense in depth. Defense in depth is the idea of having multiple layers of security in case one is not enough. Figure 1-5. Although this may seem obvious when explained so simply, deciding how many layers and which layers to have can be difficult, especially if your security budget is limited. Layers of security can be processes: checking someone's ID before giving them their mail, having to pass security testing before software can be released, physical, software, or hardware systems, a lock on a door, a network firewall, hardware encryption, built-in design choices, writing separate functions for code that handles more sensitive tasks in an application, ensuring everyone in a building must enter through one door, and so on. Figure 1-5, three layers of security for an application, an example of defense in depth. Here are some examples of using multiple layers. When creating software, having security requirements, performing threat modeling, ensuring you use secure design concepts, ensuring you use secure coding tactics, security testing, testing in multiple ways with multiple tools, etc. Each one presents another form of defense, making your application more secure. Network security, turning on monitoring, having a SIM, security information and event management, a dashboard for viewing potential security events in real time, having IPS, IDS, intrusion prevention, intrusion detection system, tools to find and stop intruders on your network, firewalls, and so much more. Each new item adds to your defenses. Physical security: locks, barbed wire, fences, gates, video cameras, security guards, guard dogs, motion sensors, alarms, etc. Quite often, the most difficult thing when advocating for security is convincing someone that one defense is not enough. Use the value of what you are protecting, reputation, monetary value, national security, etc., when making these decisions. While it makes little business sense to spend $1 million protecting something with a value of $1,000, the examples our industry sees the most often are usually reversed. Note: threat modeling. Identifying threats to your application and creating plans for mitigation. More on this in Chapter 3. SIM system. Monitoring your network and applications. A dashboard of potential problems. Intrusion prevention, detection system, IPS, IDS, software installed on a network with the intention of detecting and/or preventing network attacks. Least privilege. Giving users exactly how much access and control they need to do their jobs, but nothing more, is the concept of least privilege. The reasoning behind least privilege is that if someone were able to take over your accounts, they wouldn't get very far. If you are a software developer with access to your code and read-write access to the single database that you are working on, that means if someone were able to take over your account, they would only be able to access that one database, your code, your email, and whatever else you have access to. However, if you were the database owner on all of the databases, the intruder could potentially wipe out everything. Although it may be unpleasant to give up your superpowers on your desktop, network, or other systems, you are reducing the risk to those systems significantly by doing so. Examples of least privilege: needing extra security approvals to have access to a lab or area of your building with a higher level of security. Not having administrator privileges on your desktop at work. Having read-only access to all of your team's code and write access to your projects, but not having access to other teams' code repositories. Creating a service account for your application to access its database and giving it only read-write access, not database owner, DBO. If the application only requires read access, only give it what it requires to function properly. A service account with only read access to a database cannot be used to alter or delete any of the data, even if it could be used to steal a copy of the data. This reduces the risk greatly. Note: Software developers and system administrators are attractive targets for most malicious actors, as they have the most privileges. By giving up some of your privileges, you will be protecting your organization more than you may realize, and you will earn the respect of the security team at the same time. Supply chain security. Every item you use to create a product is considered to be part of your supply chain, with the chain including the entity, supplier of each item, manufacturer, store, farm, a person, etc. It's called a chain because each part of it depends on the previous part in order to create the final product. It can include people, companies, natural or manufactured resources, information, licenses, or anything else required to make your end product, which does not need to be physical in nature. Let's explain this a bit more clearly with an example. If Bob was building a dollhouse for his grandchildren, he might buy a kit that was made in a factory. That factory would require wood, paper, ink to create color, glue, machines for cutting, workers to run and maintain the machines, and energy to power the machines. To get the wood, the factory would order it from a lumber company, which would cut it down from a forest which it owns or has licensed access to. The paper, ink, and glue are likely all made in different factories. The workers could work directly for the company, or they could be casual contractors. The energy would most likely come from an energy company, but could potentially come from solar or wind power, or a generator in case of emergency. Figure 1-6 shows the hypothetical supply chain for the kit that Bob has purchased in order to build a dollhouse for his children for Christmas this year. Figure 1-6, a possible supply chain for Bob's dollhouse. What are the potential security, safety issues with this situation? The glue provided in this kit could be poisonous, or the ink used to decorate the pieces could be toxic. The dollhouse could be manufactured in a facility that also processes nuts, which could cross-contaminate the boxes, which could cause allergic reactions in some children. Incorrect parts could be included, such as a sharp component, which would not be appropriate for a young child. All of these situations are likely to be unintentional on the part of the factory. When creating software, we also use a supply chain. The frameworks we use to write our code, the libraries we call in order to write to the screen, to do advanced math calculations, or draw a button. The application programming interfaces, APIs, we call to perform actions on behalf of our applications, etc. Worse still, each one of these pieces usually depends on other pieces of software, and all of them are potentially maintained by different groups, companies, and/or people. Modern applications are typically made up of 20 to 40% original code, what you and your teammates wrote, with the rest being made up of these third-party components, often referred to as dependencies. When you plug dependencies into your applications, you are accepting the risks of the code they contain that your application uses. For instance, if you add something to process images into your application rather than writing your own, but it has a serious security flaw in it, your application now has a serious security flaw in it too. This is not to suggest that you could write every single line of code yourself. That would not only be extremely inefficient, but you may still make errors that result in security problems. One way to reduce the risk, though, is to use fewer dependencies and to vet carefully the ones that you do decide to include in your software. Many tools on the market, some are even free, can verify if there are any known security issues with your dependencies. These tools should be used not only every time you push new code to production, but your code repository should also be scanned regularly as well. Supply chain attack example. The open source Node.js module called Event Stream was passed on to a new maintainer in 2018, who added malicious code into it, waited until millions of people had downloaded it via NPN, the package manager for Node.js, and then used this vulnerability to steal bitcoins from copay wallets, which used the Event Stream library in their wallet software. Another defense tactic against using an insecure software supply chain is using frameworks and other third-party components made by known companies or recognized and well-respected open-source groups. Just as a chef would only use the finest ingredients in the food they make, you can, and should, take care when choosing which components make it into the final cut of your products. There have been a handful of publicly exposed supply chain attacks in recent years, where malicious actors injected vulnerabilities into software libraries, firmware, low-level software that is part of hardware, and even into hardware itself. This threat is real, and taking precautions against it will serve any developer well. Security by obscurity. The concept of security by obscurity means that if something is hidden, it will be more secure, as potential attackers will not notice it. The most common implementation of this is software companies that hide their source code, rather than putting it open on the internet. This is used as a means to protect their intellectual property and as a security measure. Some go as far as obfuscating their code, changing it such that it is much more difficult or impossible to understand if someone is attempting to reverse engineer your product. Note: obfuscation is making something hard to understand or read. A common tactic is encoding all of the source code in ASCII, Base64, or hex. But that's quite easy to see for professional reverse engineers. Some companies will double or triple encode their code. Another tactic is to XOR the code, an assembler command, or create their own encoding schema and add it programmatically. There are also products on the market that can perform more advanced obfuscation. Another example of security by obscurity is having a wireless router suppress the SSID Wi-Fi name, meaning if you want to connect, you need to know the name, or deploying a web server without a domain name, hoping no one will find it. There are tools to get around this, but it reduces your risk of people attacking your wireless router or web server. The other side of this is security by being open. The argument that if you write open source software, there will be more eyes on it, and therefore those eyes will find security vulnerabilities and report them. In practice, this is rarely true. Security researchers rarely review open source code and report bugs for free. When security flaws are reported to open source projects, they don't necessarily fix them. And if vulnerabilities are found, the finder may decide to sell them on the black market to criminals, to their own government, to foreign governments, etc., instead of reporting them to the owner of the code repository in a secure manner. Although security by obscurity is hardly an excellent defense when used on its own, it is certainly helpful as one layer of a defense-in-depth security strategy. Attack surface reduction. Every part of your software can be attacked. Each feature, input, page, or button. The smaller your application, the smaller the attack surface. If you have 4 pages with 10 functions versus 20 pages and 100 functions, that's a much smaller attack surface. Each part of your app that could potentially be exposed to an attacker is considered attack surface. Attack surface reduction means removing anything from your application that is unrequired. For instance, a feature that is not fully implemented, but you have the button grayed out, would be an ideal place to start for a malicious actor because it's not fully tested or hardened yet. Instead, you should remove this code before publishing it to production and wait until it's finished to publish it. Even if it's hidden, that's not enough. Reduce your attack surface by removing that part of your code. Tip: legacy software often has large amounts of functionality that is not used. Removing features that are not in use is an excellent way to reduce your attack surface. If you recall from earlier in the chapter, Alice and Bob both have medical implants, a device to measure insulin for Alice and a pacemaker for Bob. Both of their devices are smart, meaning they can connect to them via their smartphones. Alice's device works over Bluetooth, and Bob's works over Wi-Fi. One way for them to reduce the attack surface of their medical devices would have been to not have gotten smart devices in the first place. However, it's too late for that in this example. Instead, Alice could disable her insulin-measuring device's Bluetooth discoverable setting, and Bob could hide the SSID of his pacemaker rather than broadcasting it. Hard coding. Hard coding means programming values into the code, rather than getting the values organically from the user, database, an API, etc. For example, if you have created a calculator application and the user enters 4 plus 4, presses enter, and then the screen shows 8, you will likely assume the calculator works. However, if you enter 5 plus 5 and press enter, but the screen still shows 8, you may have a situation of hard coding. Why is hard coding a potential security issue? The reason is twofold. You cannot trust the output of the application, and the values that have been hard coded are often of a sensitive nature: passwords, API keys, hashes, etc. And anyone with access to the source code would therefore have access to those hard-coded values. We always want to keep our secrets safe, and hard-coding them into our source code is far from safe. Hard-coding is generally considered a symptom of poor software development. There are some exceptions to this. If you encounter it, you should search the entire application for hard-coding, as it is unlikely the one instance you have found is unique. Never trust, always verify. If you take away only one lesson from this book, it should be this: never trust anything outside your own application. If your application talks to an API, verify it is the correct API and that it has the authority to do whatever it's trying to do. If your application accepts data from any source, perform validation on the data. Ensure it is what you are expecting and that it is appropriate. If it is not, reject it. Even data from your own database could have malicious input or other contamination. If a user is attempting to access an area of your application that requires special permissions, re-verify they have the permission to every single page or feature they use. If a user has authenticated to your application, proven they are who they say they are, ensure you continue to validate it's the same user that you are dealing with as they move from page to page. This is called session management. Never assume because you have checked one time that everything is fine from then on. You must always verify and re-verify. Note: we verify data from our own database because it may contain stored cross-site scripting, XSS, or other values that may damage our program. Stored XSS happens when a program does not perform proper input validation and saves an XSS attack into its database by accident. When users perform an action in your application that calls that data, when it is returned to the user, it launches the attack against the user in their browser. It is an attack that a user is unable to protect themselves against, and it is generally considered a critical risk if found during security testing. Quite often, developers forget this lesson and assume trust due to context. For instance, you have a public-facing internet application, and you have extremely tight security on that web app. That web app calls an API, number one, within your network, behind the firewall, all the time, which then calls another API, number two, that changes data in a related database. Often developers don't bother authenticating, proving identity, to the first API, or have the API, number one, verify the app has authorization to call whatever part of the API it's calling. If they do, however, in this situation, they often perform security measures only on API number one and then skip doing it on API number two. This results in anyone inside your network being able to call API number two, including malicious actors who shouldn't be there, insider threats, or even accidental users. Figure 1.7, example of an application calling APIs and when to authenticate. Here are some examples. A website is vulnerable to stored cross-site scripting, and an attacker uses this to store an attack in the database. If the web application validates the data from the database, the stored attack would be unsuccessful when triggered. A website charges for access to certain data, which it gets from an API. If a user knows the API is exposed to the internet, and the API does not validate that who is calling it is allowed to use it, authentication and authorization, the user can call the API directly and get the data without paying, which would be malicious use of this website. It's theft. A regular user of your application is frustrated and pounds on the keyboard repeatedly, accidentally entering much more data than they should have into your application. If your application is validating the input properly, it would reject it if there is too much. However, if the application does not validate the data, perhaps it would overload your variables or be submitted to your database and cause it to crash. When we don't verify that the data we are getting is what we are expecting, a number in a number field, a date in a date field, an appropriate amount of text, etc., our application can fall into an unknown state, which is where we find many security bugs. We never want an application to fall into an unknown state. Usable security. If security features make your application difficult to use, users will find a way around it or go to your competitor. There are countless examples online of users creatively circumventing inconvenient security features. Humans are very good at solving problems, and we don't want security to be the problem. The answer to this is creating usable security features. While it is obvious that if we just turned the internet off, all our applications would be safer, that is obviously an unproductive solution to protecting anyone from threats on the internet. We need to be creative ourselves and find a way to make the easiest way to do something also be the most secure way to do something. Examples of usable security include allowing a fingerprint, facial recognition, or pattern to unlock your personal device instead of a long and complicated password. Teaching users to create passphrases, a sentence or phrase that is easy to remember and type, rather than having complexity rules. Ensuring a special character, number, lower, and uppercase letters are used, etc. This would increase entropy, making it more difficult for malicious actors to break the password, but it would also make it easier to use for users. Teaching users to use password managers rather than expecting them to create and remember 100-plus unique passwords for all of their accounts. Examples of users getting around security measures include users tailgating at secure building entrances, following closely while someone enters a building so that they do not need to swipe to get in. Users turning off their phones, entering through a scanner meant to detect transmitting devices, then turning it back on once in the secure area where cell phones are banned. Using a proxy service to visit websites that are blocked by your workplace network. Taking a photo of your screen to bring a copyright image or sensitive data home. Using the same password over and over, but incrementing the last number of it for easy memory. If your company forces users to reset their passwords every 90 days, there's a good chance there are quite a few passwords in your org that follow the format current season underscore current year. Factors of authentication. Authentication is proving that you are indeed the real, authentic you to a computer. A factor of authentication is a method of proving who you are to a computer. Currently, there are only three different factors: something you have, something you are, and something you know. Something you have could be a phone, computer, token, or your badge for work. Something that should only ever be in your possession. Something you are could be your fingerprint, an iris scan, your gait, the way you walk, or your DNA, something that is physically unique to you. Something you know could be a password, a passphrase, a pattern, or a combination of several pieces of information, often referred to as security questions, such as your mother's maiden name, your date of birth, and your social insurance number. The idea is that it is something that only you would know. When we log into accounts online with only a username and password, we are only using one factor of authentication, and it is significantly less secure than using two or more factors. When accounts are broken into or data is stolen, it is often due to someone using only one factor of authentication to protect the account. Using more than one factor of authentication is usually referred to as multi-factor authentication, MFA, or two-factor authentication, 2FA, or two-step login. We will refer to this as MFA from now on in this book. Tip: security questions are passé. It is simple to look up the answers to most security questions on the internet by performing open source intelligence gathering, OSINT. Do not use security questions as a factor of authentication in your software. They are too easily circumvented by attackers. When credentials, usernames with corresponding passwords, are stolen and used maliciously to break into accounts, users that have a second factor of authentication are protected. The attacker will not have the second factor of authentication and therefore will be unable to get in. When someone tries to brute force, using a script to automatically try every possible option very quickly, a system or account that has MFA enabled, even if they eventually get the password, they won't have the second factor in order to get in. Using a second factor makes your online account significantly more difficult to break into. Examples of MFA include multi-factor, entering your username and password, then having to use a second device or physical token to receive a code to authenticate. The username and password are one factor, something you know, and using a second device is the second factor, something you have. Not a multi-factor, a username and a password. This is two examples of the same factor. They are both something that you know. Multi-factor authentication means that you have more than one of the different types of factors of authentication, not one or more of the same factor. Not multi-factor, using a username and password and then answering security questions. These are two of the same factor, something you know. Multi-factor, username and password, then using your thumbprint. Note, many in the information security industry are in disagreement as to whether or not using your phone to receive an SMS, text message, with a PIN code is a good implementation of MFA, as there are known security flaws within the SMS protocol and some implementations of it. It is my opinion that having a pretty darn good second factor, rather than only having one factor, is better. Whenever possible, however, ask users to use an authentication application instead of SMS text messages as the second factor. Exercises. These exercises are meant to help you understand the concepts in this chapter. Write out the answers and see which ones you get stuck on. If you have trouble answering some of the questions, you may want to re-listen to the chapter. Every chapter will have exercises like these at the end. If there is a term you are unfamiliar with, look it up in the glossary at the end of the book. That may help with your understanding. If you have a colleague or professional mentor who you can discuss the answers with, that would be the best way to find out if you are right or wrong and why. Some of the answers are not Boolean, true or false, and are just to make you contemplate the problem. Number one. Bob sets the Wi-Fi setting on his pacemaker to not broadcast the name of his Wi-Fi. What is this defensive strategy called? Number two, name an example of a value that could be hard-coded and why. What would be the motivation for the programmer to do that? Number three, is a CAPTCHA usable security? Why or why not? Number four, give one example of a good implementation of usable security. Number five, when using information from the URL parameters, do you need to validate the data? Why or why not? Number six, if an employee learns a trade secret at work and then sells it to a competitor, this breaks which parts of the CIA? Number seven, if you buy a smart refrigerator and connect it to your home network, then have a malicious actor connect to it and change the settings so that it's slightly warmer and your milk goes bad, which parts of the CIA did they break? Number eight, if someone hacks into your smart thermostat and turns off your heat, which parts of the CIA did they break? Number 9, if a programmer adds an Easter egg, extra code that does undocumented functionality as a surprise for users, which is unknown to management and the security team. Does this qualify as an insider threat? If so, why? If not, why not? Number 10, when connecting to a public Wi-Fi, what are some of the precautions that you could take to ensure you are doing defense in depth? Number 11, if you live in an apartment with several roommates and you all have a key to the door, is one of the keys considered to be a factor of authentication? Chapter 2, Security Requirements. When you create any application or embark on any project, you must have requirements for what you are going to build. This is true no matter what development methodology you use, waterfall, agile, DevOps, language or framework you write it in, or type of audience you serve. Without a plan, you cannot build something of substance. If you have studied computer science or computer engineering, the image shown in Figure 2.1 is likely burned into your brain. It is commonly known as the System Development Lifecycle, SDLC, and it consists of 5 phases: requirements, design, coding, testing, and release. As this book progresses, we will refer back to this image in order to explain when each activity we talk about can and or should occur. This chapter will revolve around the requirements phase. Figure 2.1, the System Development Lifecycle, SDLC. Tip: SDLC is sometimes defined as the software development lifecycle, focusing on software rather than system. The two definitions are used interchangeably. When you have your very first project meeting, often called a project kickoff meeting, there should be a person from the security team present to take part in the project from its very inception. Even though this person will not be working full-time on the project, they should be part of the team and make themselves available regularly to ensure that all security questions and concerns are addressed in a timely manner. Assigning a security person to a project team is sometimes called the partnership model, or the person is referring to as being matrixed into the team. No matter what you call it, this person is there to ensure that security's interests, CIA, are represented throughout the entire project. Note, the exact origin of the partnership model is unknown. I first learned of it from the Netflix AppSec team. The expression of being matrixed into a project was first introduced to me at the Treasury Board Secretariat of Canada and is, again, of unknown origin. This chapter will assume that you have a basic understanding of how IT projects and software development processes work. Tip: create a support level agreement, SLA, between the security team and the other teams in order to define what a reasonable amount of time is to wait for a response to requests to the security team. Often security teams become the bottleneck of projects, and when an SLA is in place, this is less likely to happen. For best results, set conservative goals at first and aim to improve over time. Requirements. Software project requirements should always include security questions. Following are the types of questions that security professionals should be asking when assisting with requirements gathering and analysis. Does the system contain or come in contact with confidential, sensitive, or personally identifiable information, PII data? Where and how is the data being stored? Will this application be available to the public, internet, or internally only, intranet? Does this application perform sensitive or essential tasks, such as transferring money, unlocking doors, or delivering medicine? Does this application perform any risky software activities, such as allowing users to upload files? What level of availability do you need? Does it require 99.999% uptime? Note, almost no systems actually require that level of uptime. Ideally, when creating a list of requirements, the security representative should ask questions and then add the appropriate security requirements to the list of requirements for the project. For instance, will your application allow users to upload files? Yes? Okay then. Let's add the following security requirements to that project requirements document to ensure they design it securely from the start. As someone creating software, it is part of your responsibility to protect the security, safety, and privacy of your users. These requirements will help ensure that you do. The following sections detail security requirement definitions and explanations. At the end of this chapter, you'll find a checklist of requirements that could be added to any web application project requirements document. Encryption. Cryptography is a type of math that can be applied to information in order to make its value no longer understandable. It is used to hide secrets and ensure privacy of communications. Encryption is two-way, in that you can jumble up the information into an unreadable mess and then decrypt it back into its original form. Hashing is one way. The original value can never be recovered. Encryption is used quite often to protect secrets or to transmit data, because the system needs that data back later. The value is in the data. Hashing is most often used to prove identity, to authenticate to a system, to verify the integrity of your data, or some sort of challenge or verification. For example, no one cares what your password actually is. They just want to know if they should let you into the system or not. The data is not the value, proving your identity is. You know the original value, the password, which proves your identity. Hashing a value also means that if the value is ever leaked, it is unusable. Leaked passwords that are in an altered and hashed format don't do the thief any good, as you would enter them into the system and they would not be recognized as your password. Note: although there are currently concerns about quantum computing making our current forms of cryptography and encryption obsolete, this book will presume that has not happened yet. There is no known date as to when this will occur, and no one, including me, currently has a working quantum-resistant encryption algorithm or strategy that is proven as of this writing. As such, this topic is out of scope for this book. In order to ensure the confidentiality of your data, it should be encrypted in transit, on its way to and from the user, the database, an API, etc., and at rest, while in the database. It should be noted that this ensures no one will learn your secrets. If someone were to gain unauthorized access to your data or intercept your traffic with a sniffing tool, they would not be able to understand what they have found. This does not, however, protect the availability of your data or its integrity. Someone could still delete or change the data in your database. It would be obvious it was changed or removed, but also quite inconvenient if your backups and rollbacks are not perfectly seamless. A malicious actor could intercept your traffic and change or block your messages, which again would cause problems. That said, protecting your secrets, the C in CIA, is vital, and thus, no matter what system you are creating, you will want to ensure the data is encrypted, not hashed, in transit and at rest. Some may argue that data should even be encrypted while in use, in memory. But unless you are dealing with extremely sensitive data, this is generally not expected as a project requirement. To protect highly sensitive data, it is recommended that you flush the memory when your program exits, logs out, or is otherwise ended. Never trust system input. Any input to your system could potentially be tampered with or otherwise cause your application to malfunction or fail. Whether this input is intentionally malicious or not, if it causes your application to go into an unknown state,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.